Greetings and welcome to On Hold with Atchka. I'm Shannon, and today we've got a very interesting interview for you with MeMe Roth, president of the National Action Against Obesity, thing. I'm not really sure what they do, but I'm sure it's impacting obesity. In fact, since it's begun in 2000, whatever, obesity hasn't risen one bit, and I'm confident that it's due to the efforts of Ms. Roth and others like her. So, want to hear something interesting? That is MeMe Roth unable to answer a simple question based on the argument she's presenting. Want to hear it again? Beautiful, huh? I just like to stipulate up front, I'm not a journalist, I'm a writer. There's a difference to me. I do have a set of ethics, but they're not based on anything that's been written down. It's based on my own code of honor. And, you'll notice that I've interviewed people in the past and was intending to be respectful to Ms. Roth as well for the duration, but she came out swinging, so to speak, and I felt the need to correct a few things that she claimed, and eventually it seemed to get more and more tense as time went on. So sorry for the long intro. I know people hate that, but I'm just very excited about this interview and I hope you enjoy.
I'm speaking with MeMe Roth, president and founder of National Action Against Obesity. She's also a health counselor of integrative nutrition. And we're speaking today about health at every size. So I was wondering, have you read about health at every size? Are you aware of what it stands for?
Sure. Yeah, generally speaking, I am, I hear about it pretty regularly.
Okay. And what do you think about it?
Well, I wish it were true. I really do. I think that exercise at every size is healthy, but I wish that every size were healthy, and unfortunately that's pretty misleading based on everything that we know about obesity and the ravages to our body that come with that.
Mm-hmm. Now, the health at every size name, it doesn't mean that everybody, all fat people are healthy. As I understand it, it's, people that are overweight have a certain set point, and if they are, overweight but eating healthy and being active, that they can be healthy too, that they don't need to be skinny to be healthy. Is that...
Sounds like the name needs to change. I thought it was healthy at every size. So not every size. Is that what you're suggesting?
Well,
I'm confused. I mean, when I read about it, when I hear about it, what is suggested is that being dangerously over fat is actually also capable of being healthy. And that's just simply not true. What we know from an orthopedic standpoint is that there's a quite a bit of duress on the joints, and we're even seeing an increase in splayed feet due to obesity. You also have the situation of inflammation, which is considered a silent killer. It leads to precursor to stroke, diabetes, heart attack. And when you have extra adiposity, you are at a state of chronic inflammation. And then finally, and unfortunately, and really frightening, is the fact that when you have excess body fat, especially in the central section of our body, we're finding that is converting into estrogen. So for men, that means your testosterone is being converted into estrogen, and we really are seeing ourselves become a nation of women. That's true for men, women, and children. When you have extra fat on you and you are awash in estrogen, for a man, that's resulting in motility issues with sperm, low sperm count. We're also, there's the man boobs, I think, that everyone knows about. But we're also seeing erectile dysfunction, less in libido, and that's bad news for the men and anyone in their bed.
Well, these things that you're mentioning are I've read the studies on them, and they apply to the extreme ends of weight. And
how do you define the extreme ends? I mean, we hit obesity at about 30 pounds above a healthy weight range. So, So do you, where are you calling, where do you draw the line on what is risk and dangerous? But let me just finish my point. At a point of around 30, you know, a BMI, and a, you know, unless you're a bodybuilder or a professional athlete, that's someone who's probably dangerously overweight. And if you've gotten to the point of 30 pounds above a healthy weight, that's also dangerous. I mean, it can be dangerous far before that. And the last thing I want to say about this problem with excess estrogen due to excess fat is, you know, we're seeing little girls get their periods in first grade instead of eighth grade due to excess fat, and little boys on the cusp of puberty, when they're supposed to become awash in testosterone, have excess estrogen coursing through their bodies. So when you look at the long-term anthropologic implications, it's pretty frightening. And, you know, we're already seeing early evidence, like I said, in what's happening with men and their erectile dysfunction, libido, and sperm problems.
Okay, but you know, I'd like to go back to the whole libido and sperm count and everything. Again, it's a bell curve. It's not like if you get to a BMI of 30, you suddenly become impotent. It's the extreme ends of the bell curve can cause these things, and it seems like you're kind of conflating that and making it sound like all overweight men, all men who reach a BMI of 30 aren't going to be able to get it up, and it seems like that's a scare tactic that's been used before.
I think what we need to look at is not what's pleasant, not what's some sort of socially acceptable truth. We need to look at the factual truth, and the facts are the high risks associated with being overfat, and one of them is an estrogen problem in men, women, and children,
at the extreme
and lessened libido and sperm problems. Look, we're seeing a higher incidence of infertility for both men and women trying to become parents due to obesity, and we're also a nation where more of us are obese than overweight. So I think it's important to focus on obesity, not just, you know, slightly overweight, because that's really where we are as a nation. And also, I know you know this, Shannon, typically obesity is a progressive situation. So a child who's perhaps just a little overfat typically will become an adult who is very overfat. It just kind of trends that way. And you know, I don't know if you know much about my personal history. I grew up in a family where obesity was dominant, and you know, my mother's over 200 pounds, my father 300 pounds, my aunts, uncles, my grandmother, for decades had just severe obesity at maybe 5'2" at 300 pounds. So I think for a lot of people, obesity is new to them or new to their families. For me, it's all I've ever known. And when you see what it does to people over the years, over the decades, it's really hard to act like it's some far-reaching, far-fetched idea for these dramatic results of it, because I've seen it. You know, I've certainly seen the results, and it gets you to the point where obesity takes you to where you're immobile. You lose so much of your capability, you lose so much of your drive when you don't feel like yourself, you don't look like yourself, and then you get to the point where you can't even move around properly, and then, you know, it's that terrible vicious cycle where you have so few pleasures that food becomes even more of the primary source of pleasure than it even was when it made you become obese.
Okay, but I have a question. I'm getting back to health at every size. They're encouraging people to eat healthy, be active, and have a positive body image.
Well, I think that exercising daily is important for every one of us, regardless of our size.
Right.
So I am a huge fan of that. As you know, I knock out 4 miles a day, and I it's not something I feel like doing most days, but it's something I feel like I have to do if I want to stay healthy, feel great, and be in a healthy weight range. Eating foods that are free of toxins or obesity and disease-promoting substances is a great idea. Drinking water instead of sweetened drinks is a great idea. So I absolutely encourage and support everything that you've said about that. I don't think that's what healthy at every size means. But
have you read Linda Bacon's book or read any of the studies that back up the evidence of health at every size?
Well, I'm confused on what you're defining as health at every size. The name sounds wrong. If you're saying eating healthfully no matter what size you are, yes, I agree with that. If you're saying exercise daily no matter what size you are, I agree with that. You're saying that health at every size, meaning that you're healthy at every size, then I absolutely disagree with
that.
So it depends how you're defining it.
I'm actually referring to the book that Linda Bacon wrote that is actually kind of the foundation of what health at every size actually means. And
well,
that has to do with So it seems like if you're going to be speaking out against health at every size, you should know what they're actually promoting and not just what the name says.
I think that I'm very clear. I think the name is a terribly misleading name, and so I speak out against that name. I couldn't be
but
more...
But not the actual concepts that
I couldn't
are,
be
are
more,
the name.
Well, I want to be specific. I doubt I agree with everything in her book, but what I want to be specific
but you haven't
about...
Read.
What I'd like to be specific about is that I promote exercising daily no matter what size you are, and I promote eating, making healthful food choices no matter what size you are. That's where I absolutely positively agree with anyone who supports those same messages.
Okay.
But believe me, I've read enough articles and seen enough information about that movement that whatever is or isn't specifically in the book, the application and what I read about it is there are probably many things that are contradictory to my thinking. But
okay.
if you're saying the full definition of health at every size only means to eat healthy foods and to exercise daily, then I would support that. That is not my understanding of every aspect about that. I don't think anyone is going to have a positive body image, regardless of the euphemisms, if they know that they're not eating healthily, they're not taking care of their bodies, they're not exercising daily. It's really hard to feel good if you're not doing those things. So it's hard to feel good about your body when you're not doing good things for it.
Well, here's my next question. You often cite that 2/3 of the country are overweight or obese, and you also say that you know dieting doesn't work. That people who become overweight or obese, 90% of them will not be able to diet and keep it off.
Well, okay, go ahead with your question because there's a few things about that are probably not quite. But go ahead. Uh-huh.
Well, so if people you know once they gain the weight, they are you know it's nearly impossible for them to lose it, which is something you've said. I've read. That you've written.
No.
If it's nearly impossible, then why be so vitriolic about fat people? Why go after the people who are already fat when it seems
okay.
like you want to go after people who are in danger of becoming fat?
Okay. First of all, I do go after. My focus is reversing the obesity trends. My main thrust is prevention, and I am in no way vitriolic. So, you know, I don't know if you want to be a journalist or if you're putting your personal opinions in there.
Well, I read on your blog the other day talking about how fat people shit on themselves. I mean, you. That was
no,
on your blog.
Excuse me, would you be specific? I was specifically...
Yeah, it says, imagine shitting yourself in bed rather than making the full effort to get 5 feet to the bathroom. That's obesity.
Did you read that in its full context? That
oh, yeah,
a
I read
specific,
the whole thing.
That, you know, Shannon, that is a specific story about my grandmother. Mm-hmm. And that is exactly where it took her. And I think people need to understand that when you become immobile due to obesity, you would be shocked with what changes in your life. And that is, I did not say all people will do that. But I can tell you I have lived that. My grandmother lives that. My grandmother got to the point where it wasn't worth it to her to get out of the bed to go to the bathroom. And when you love someone and you care for them and you're trying to help them and it gets to that point, it is devastating. And as someone, when that happens in your family, then you and I can discuss that. But I take offense.
It has happened to somebody in my family.
Okay, well, then you can understand how obesity can take people there. But let's go back
right,
to another
point.
Right,
but nobody is shitting themselves in bed in my family that I know.
But I thought you just said that it did. I'm specifically talking about that occurrence, and I don't think we need to overdwell on it. I have never said it is all people.
Well, but there's other things you said. You said it's wrong to be fat. You said dump your friends who plan to grow fatter every year. I mean, these are... You said in the...
All right, let's take them one by one. I think that you're getting, you know, why don't you, you know, take a breath. Let's hit them one by one. I'm happy to talk about them one by one, okay? So let's go back to, why don't you ask me a specific question about, you know, one or two things, and I'll try to address the one or two things at a time, and then hopefully we'll hit all of them.
Well, okay. You said in the green room at the Mike and Julie show that we need to separate self-worth from fat. And
yes.
Then you also have said it's wrong to be fat. So if someone is fat and you say it's wrong to be fat, then you're making a moral judgment. You're talking about their self-worth. You're telling
okay.
them that they are wrong for being fat.
What you said a little while ago about weight loss and dieting and all of that, let's answer what you're asking right now by talking about that.
Okay.
We know there's a failure rate of dieting. Right, there's a failure weight of losing weight and keeping it off.
Mm-hmm.
However, that isn't because people aren't capable of losing weight and keeping it off. It's that people don't. Mm-hmm. So observing that there is a failure to keep weight off is not the same.
Have you read the studies?
Well, you know, I pretty much do nothing but read information about nutrition. So let me answer the question.
Okay.
So I just want you to be clear about my position on that.
Okay.
Is that people who lose weight typically fail to keep it off.
Mm-hmm.
So knowing that, I do not think the focus in reversing obesity should be telling people to lose weight. Not because most people can't lose weight and keep it off, but because most people won't lose weight and keep it off. It is so difficult to not become overweight in this environment already that once someone has, it's even harder for them to take that weight off and keep it off.
Because why? I'm sorry.
You know, they're physiologically altered.
Right.
That once your body gets to the highest weight, your body tries to maintain that weight. It doesn't mean it can't be done. It means that you take someone who already had issues, most likely around food. You take someone who already is at a disadvantage, and then now they're at even a greater physiological disadvantage because they've gained the weight in the first place. So it's not that they can't do it. It's that it's even harder for them to do it. And
right.
We know the failure rate is 95%. So for me, if we're talking about reversing the obesity trend, you have to take people who are already overweight and do everything you can to try so that they don't gain more weight.
And
you also do everything.
Okay,
let me finish my point. The other thing you need to do is do everything you can to reduce their risk for chronic disease, which goes back to what I believe, which is exercising every day and making the most healthful food choices possible. That's a benefit
which is
to
what
everyone.
Health at Every Size promotes, according to Linda Bacon.
Okay. So then,
so you agree with Health at Every Size?
I will never agree with that name, but I agree with the two things I've said over and over. So Shannon,
okay,
let's
so you
go back
agree
to
with the concepts that are central to Health at Every Size.
I would never say that because from what I understand, I don't. I agree with the two things that I've said.
But
the
three central tenets of Health at Every Size is eat healthy, be active, and have a positive body image. What are you against of those three things?
I am for eating healthily regardless of your size. I'm for exercising daily regardless of your size. And I believe if you take care of your body, that is the best way to feel good about your body. I would not label that anything other than those are the things that I believe. The name Health at Every Size I think is terribly misleading. But let me go back to reversing obesity.
So is one size fits all.
I don't know who says that. Okay, so let's go back to reversing obesity. When you are, again, we've addressed the failure rate, we've addressed, you know, exercising daily, eating healthful foods, reducing the risk for chronic disease, and trying to make sure people who are already over fat don't get extra fat on them. So that's the first group. The second group where we need to put a great deal of resources is the pre-pregnancy to five-year-olds. Their eating habits aren't set, their exercise habits are not set, and their body composition is not yet set. So you want to make sure to foster a new generation, Generation H, for healthy, where they're taught from the get-go about proper eating, enjoying healthful foods, occasional indulgences rather than daily indulgences, and that daily exercise. So if we can foster this new generation that doesn't get overfat in the first place, so they're never in a position to go, you know, to be pressured to do fad diets or to be pressured to try to drop weight once it's become difficult. I'm sure you know this as well as I do. Preventing obesity is far easier than trying to lose weight later, and all the numbers support that. So for my efforts, it's about this prevention. It's about graduating ourselves out of obesity by focusing on the pre-pregnancy to five-year-olds. So that's the two-pronged mode that I greatly believe in, and to do that, we need it's not a project for the first lady. This obesity thing is one of the most pressing health crises we have, and so it's about an executive order that says, done, we're not marketing junk food to children anymore. It's about new policies where there is no junk food in daycare centers, where there is no junk food in children's schools.
Well, let's talk about that.
I don't
that.
Even
let's
know why about... we're debating those
well,
things.
Well, no, I'm not.
I don't mean you.
Right.
We've been debating marketing junk food to children since the Carter administration.
Well, and that's a function of corporate interest. That's not.
Yeah, of
that's
course.
Not
which is
people.
Which
fat
is what makes
are,
our.
Fat people are not encouraging advertising of junk food to children.
I don't know why you would suggest that. Is that what you believe? Because I've never suggested such a thing.
No, I'm just saying that it sounds like you are fighting against obesity. Okay, and I can get behind some of the things you say.
You have to understand that when I say obesity is the ravages to the body that come from obesity. Obesity is the type 2 diabetes, the cancer, the dementia, the stroke, the immobility, the loss of self-esteem, all the things that come with obesity, that's obesity.
Well, let me ask you this.
Not the person. The person is the person. The obesity is something that I think we all should try to reverse.
And that's, I understand, and I agree that you know, at the extreme ends, obesity has profound health effects. But one thing that's not being studied is that when these studies come out correlating obesity with heart disease and various diseases, you don't hear about any correlation between diet and exercise and lifestyle.
Are you saying one, or are you saying me? I'm confused.
No, I'm just saying that the studies are...
No, I think all the studies support that daily exercise is beneficial to everybody.
Right,
There's
no study, because there's a high correlation between obesity and poverty. There's a high correlation...
You know what? When you're at two-thirds overweight, I think there's a high correlation of obesity in all of us. The unfortunate thing, and I think we should talk a little bit more about this quote-unquote solution for reversing obesity, is we need to have, if the government's going to subsidize food, it can't be corn. It's got to be broccoli, avocado. It has to be the foods that promote health. Also, we need to make sure recreational facilities are both safe and accessible to all people. We do want to pay particular attention to those most in need, and also Americans of color, we know, are suffering greatly. Our indigenous American people, our African American people, just about everyone of color suffers the consequences of obesity at far lower body fat percentages than Caucasians. So we need to pay particular attention to that, but I think that we know it's affecting all of us. I can't think of one group, the rich, the poor, or everybody in between.
That's really not true, because studies have come out saying that people in the highest brackets of income, the wealthier you are, the less obesity is a problem for that.
Yes, but when you've got two-thirds of your country over fat, it is affecting everybody. It is true that the wealthiest Caucasians have a lesser incidence of obesity than the poorest Latino, you know, females. That's absolutely true. But I think we have to address it for all people, because we know that it's affecting all people.
Okay,
but
here's my next question: You've used the statistic that gaining merely 10 to 20 pounds after age 18 increases your chance of premature death by 15%.
That's based on the nurses' study, and you know, Walter Willett, who I'm sure you're very familiar with, out of Harvard. And the whole idea is a woman is full grown by about age 18, and a man is full grown about, you know, 21, 22. If you arrive at adulthood at a healthy weight, there's every expectation that you should be maintaining that weight throughout your adult life. Now, if you put on muscle afterward, that's one thing, but there is not a need, and there very well seems to be a risk with putting on extra fat once you're full grown.
Okay,
I think we've lost sight of what the idea of full grown is. You're done when you're full grown.
Yes, we have lost sight, because here's my question. You've cited the nurse's study, but Catherine Flegel's study suggested that people in the overweight BMI category have a decreased mortality of 85,000 adults.
You know,
and
what
that,
really
that
I think
statistic is actually used on the Centers of Science and the Public Interest, which are associated with. They quote Catherine.
I'm not disputing.
Study.
I'm not disputing that there are a couple mortality studies that show that. I guess I would have you know
studies
that mortality
is healthier than normal.
No, wait a second. No, there's not one study that says it's healthier. Here's what I would.
Shannon, I can cite them all.
Shannon,
yeah.
You're talking about mortality. All the studies show that while you may live as long or longer than someone at a healthy weight, you won't be living as healthy as. And now you've seen those studies. Mortality is not the end-all, be-all. I can tell you, as someone who lives in a family of obese people, my grandmother may make it to 90 or 100. She may. However, she hasn't been out of bed in years, and she's been immobile for decades. And not getting out of bed increases her chance.
Let me ask you this: is she active and eating healthy?
Well, now she's in a 24-hour care facility,
okay,
staring at a hummingbird sphere.
Because
9 times out of 10, obesity is the result of habitual improper eating.
Where did you get that statistic? 9 times out of 10? Like, how do you know that 90% of fat people are fat
It's probably a greater figure than that.
Really?
The people...
But where do you back that up with? You are an advocate against obesity, and you're throwing out statistics that aren't based in fact.
I'm sure that both of us can find evidence that the great majority of people who are over fat are overfat due to habitual improper eating.
Okay,
it's not eating cake and ice cream on your birthday.
If you find that statistic, could you send it to me?
Okay, that was the first part of the interview. As you can tell, it's getting a little tense. But the second half is really what you want to stick around for. But first, let's take a quick break with Satellite of Love as they explain something apropos of, you know, something.
Oh, gosh, I'm sorry, pal. I've been so distracted. I just keep thinking about that slick gas station in today's movie. Did you notice how sleek and beautiful it was?
Gee, no, Joel. I can't say as I did. Cuckoo, cuckoo.
Hey, come on. I'm serious. There existed a time when our nation took pride in its service station. They gleamed like a beacon of hope from coast to coast. Then one day, kablooey. You know, Sky Chief Super Service turned into the tank and tummy. I don't mind telling you guys. The day this country went self-service was the day that hell began to bubble up and flood the earth.
No, I hate to burst your bubble, Joel, but what about the bubonic plague, World War, Stalin?
Well, come on, those are all big things. You know, hell works better when it's a lot more subtle. Here, I'll give you an example. Okay. Crow, what do you think of Adolf Hitler?
Well, I hate him, naturally.
Right, now, what do you think of the band Styx?
Well, you know, they had one or two decent... Oh, my God, you're right!
I get it now, Joel. Oh. I'm not certain when hell started for me, but I think it has something to do with Christopher Cross.
Yeah. Well, remember the time that Charlie Weaver died and it wasn't even in the papers?
Yeah. Or when the 86 jarts.
I think the first time Flo said, "Kiss my grits," something inside all of us withered and died.
Using Joe Camel to sell cigarettes to kids seems like a pretty ripe slice of hell.
Yeah, I agree with that. And then there was the time Dennis Leary released No Cure for Cancer as an album. And then the time Vicki Lawrence won a Grammy for The Night the Lights Went Out in Georgia.
I know I stand alone on this, but the day Blansky's Beauties got canceled.
Yeah, you stand alone on that.
Yeah, pretty much.
Sinbad's pretty icky.
Yeah, what about the Charlene Tilton workout video?
Joel, what chance do we have in a world that keeps presenting us with vivid images of hell?
Well, there's personal liberty, strength of conviction. Those have been known to work. Mm-hmm. Then there's the time the country rallies together to beat back hell, like the time we as a nation said no to Yahoo Sirius.
I remember that. All of us together, drawn inexplicably to the slobbering mouth of hell, and then suddenly, somehow, by some unknown force, rescued in the nick of time like Moses and the Israelites.
Now, who in creation is powerful enough to do that?
Gee, Davy, do you think it was God?
We'll be right back.
Ow.
Well, let me ask you, of all the people you know who are overfat, what percentage have Prader-Willi? What percentage have Cushing syndrome? What percentage have pica?
What percentage have depression? What percentage have eating disorders? What percentage have taken medication that causes weight gain? What percentage have diabetes?
No.
Diabetes is a cyclical condition that causes weight gain as well as is affected by weight gain. It's cyclical.
Now, wait a second. I guess where I disagree with you fundamentally is you can sit alone in a room with depression and not get fat. You can sit alone in the room with media and not get fat. You can sit alone in a room with almost everything that people blame on obesity. It's the food. Now, what I would suggest, and I think the country greatly needs, is we know there's neuromarketing going on now. Every food marketer knows a couple things. They do all these fMRI brain scans. They're putting millions, investing millions into figuring out how to formulate, package, and market food to us to bypass all reason. That doesn't hold us irresponsible for ourselves. We're still ultimately responsible, but we know that the food marketers are putting everything they can against us to bypass all reason. So they do these brain scans to figure out how to light up just about every part of our brain.
The dopamine receptors. They light up.
Well, dopamine is about the craving and the opioids release right. when you satisfy that craving.
Which is the same. It's the same pleasure center that drug addicts get, right?
Well, and sex and you
and
know
sex,
sleep,
yeah.
right?
And
okay,
pleasurable,
yeah. right? But so they're working against us. Let's be honest, Shane. They're working against us. So it doesn't mean so they've got that going on, right? So to bypass all reason, and they're using these fMRI scans, so they're doing neuromarketing. We also, I don't know about you, I didn't grow up with particularly good eating habits. I don't know if you did. I didn't. And
my mom was extremely healthy.
Well, that's great. Mine wasn't. So I've had to put down a lot of bad habits myself, and I'm not 100% successful at doing that. I doubt I ever will be.
And I was raised with good habits, and I'm fat.
Okay. Well, I was raised not in particularly good habits, but I've had to watch my weight since I was about 12, and I assure you I could be fat as easy as just about anybody else. I have to be very careful not to be. So here's the thing. We know there's neuromarketing going on. We know that we've got a lot of people in our country who weren't lucky like you were and taught healthful eating practices as a child. So we've habituated most of us to poor eating habits. We also have created this environment where we practically live in a brothel, but no one's supposed to have sex. I mean, there is nonstop artificial cues for us to eat. You can't go anywhere without eating, seeing food, smelling food, hearing about food. You can't turn on the TV without the, you know, nonstop food networks, which we have an involuntary response to that, Shannon. Even if you're not hungry, not physically hungry, if someone cracks open something on the bus to eat, it says to you, your survival instinct, Shannon, someone's eating. If you don't eat, you're going to die. Someone in the tribe has food. You better make sure you have food. So you're sitting there minding your own business, and now all these artificial cues say, Shannon, eat, eat, eat. So unless you're completely on guard saying, well, look, I would like to eat, and that looks delicious, but I think I won't because this is an artificial cue, and I've got a neurochemical response happening telling me to eat, but I'm not really hungry. How many of us have that kind of, you know, who besides me, I don't know anyone who tries to approach the world that way. So we have all these things working against us. So, yeah, we need to get the policies right if we're going to have government involved with food. And you know as well as I do that the food pyramid is BS. That's lobbyist interest. So we've got policy problems and the failure of will to do anything about it at a political level because of corporate interests. And it's a $500 trillion industry, this food industry. So, you know, Obama's not in a rush to do anything with that because of the economic situation. You're not going to, if people only ate what they needed, whoa, you know, Coke, Pepsi, Kraft, ConAgra, right, then I'll be in trouble. Okay.
Well, here's
wait, I do want to finish. I'm sorry I'm long-winded, but let me finish this thought. So you've got a whole environment working against us culturally, politically, in a lot of ways. And then you have this whole neurochemical thing where we don't even know what's happening to us. Mm-hmm. Well, if we're going to fix it, yeah, you need to make sure that people have nutrition information and education. Yeah, you got to make sure we have recreational facilities and people getting their daily exercise. But we also need some sort of counseling because people need to change their behaviors and their psychology. So when you talk about depression and poor body image and eating disorders of any kind, well, yeah, Shannon, people need psychological help or professional counseling. It's not enough to tell them the right foods and the right exercise because people's minds are all messed up because we've jaded them
so
by their experience as an American.
So are you trying to shock them into, like, changing their mindset? I mean, the what sticks in my mind of your work is when you were talking about Jennifer Love Hewitt, and you hold up a pair of size 14 pants and talk about how fat American women's butts are. And that, to me, I mean, I can see where you're trying to scare people into not wanting to be a size 14, but what about the women who are size 14 and above who are, you've already said that they're going to have a hard time trying to lose that weight. What message are you sending to them? You are mocking them. You're mocking them on public television. You are mocking them in a public arena and saying, look how fat your ass is. That's wrong. That's wrong.
Here's what I think. First of all, when you mentioned Jennifer Love Hewitt, some people think I've criticized her. I've never criticized her.
I didn't say that.
No, I just want
you
to be clear.
You criticized American women who are size 14.
Here's the thing. I want people
That's actually worse because there's a lot more women that are size 14 than look like Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Well, you're certainly right. I think that if you are 5'4" and 163 pounds, which is the average American woman who's on average wearing what's today called a size 14, a generation or two ago would be a size 18, people have normalized this idea of obesity. People have stopped recognizing what is and is not over fat.
That's and fine, but you're still mocking them.
I don't see it as mocking. When you hold, I didn't, look, a size 14.
You were laughing. You were holding them up and laughing about how fat, look how big your ass is. I mean, it's really, how can you not say that's not mocking?
Here's my point. My point is we cannot pretend that a 5'4" woman in today's size 14 isn't too fat and at an unhealthy level. And it is. It's too big. We've seen it so much we've stopped seeing it. And I think we all need to be shocked back awake to realize that we are much too fat and it is not based based on medical conditions or anything other than improper eating.
But a
so
size 14
us,
is not obese necessarily. A
size well, it depends how tall you are.
Exactly.
It depends
but
how tall you are.
A size 14 in the overweight category can still be healthy.
Well, see, now here's where we need to get into vanity sizing. I don't know what a size 14 is anymore. I think that
okay,
all the 5'4", all the women's clothing.
Let's say 5'4", 165.
Yeah,
that's
a problem.
But that's still a BMI.
Unless you're a bodybuilder.
That's still overweight.
I don't. You know, is it at 5'4"?
But you know.
I think at 5'4", you're in 165. You're really unless you're a bodybuilder. If you're 5'4" and 165, you're that's dangerously over fat.
Okay. Well,
if that's the average American woman, and I think Shannon, you may not agree with my mode, but let me tell you. The whole idea is to stop accepting that there's nothing we can do about this and stop accepting it as normal.
By
it's statistically
people.
What I do may shock people, but it is statistically become normal to become over fat.
But
it is so dangerous that we need to stop accepting that as an expectation and as a norm because it is so detrimental to our health. And the message to the next generation has to be one of, yeah, you are in control of this. You are capable of eating healthfully. You are capable of getting that daily exercise, even if the culture works against you and some of the policies work against you. You have to assume that responsibility because I don't know how you do it, but I know if I don't know that I'm ultimately accountable, it reduces my motivation. I need to know
okay.
that it's my that it is or isn't my fault if I do or don't take care of my
right.
body.
Openly accountable and your methods have been employed by everybody who's not fat since the beginning of time. Kids get mocked and told that they're so fat all their life. We've had the message of the obesity epidemic for 10 years, and yet, first of all, the numbers haven't gone up. And second of all, it doesn't work.
No, wait a second. You're saying there hasn't been an increase in obesity in the last 30 to 50 years?
No,
it's
I
been
said
a dramatic.
10.
Oh, 10. Well, yeah, we've been fat for a while now. That's true. My goodness.
The study that just came out like yesterday.
Yeah, it's leveled off. It's leveled off. But
for the last 10 years, during the entire obesity panic.
But Shannon, thank goodness the numbers are so horrifically high. Oh, my gosh. At some point, there's no one left who isn't over fat.
Those numbers went up when they readjusted the BMI for overweight down to 25.
Look,
they shot up by half.
Let me tell you something. I got no problem with BMI as an initial screening. It's not a final diagnosis, and no, it doesn't work for bodybuilders. But most people who hit a very high or a 30 or up on the BMI, almost every one of them is over fat. I've got no problem. It's non-invasive, very low cost. It's a great first screening. It's not a great final diagnosis, but I think it's a really practical, decent initial screening.
Okay. Well, I've got one more question, and then I think we're reaching the end of the time you've allotted for me. So I don't want to keep you any past that. A lot of your appeals that I've read, you've got the brain, body, libido. You focus on the sex aspect of obesity, that getting fat means you're not going to have the sex drive that other people do, and things like that. First of all, there was a study that said that fat women have more sex than thin women. So how does that relate to
that study made me feel really sad because, that study made me feel sad for people.
Because you're not having enough sex or what?
Oh, Shannon, am I supposed to compare how much I have sex versus how much you have sex? I think that's really...
I don't want to compare that, but,
Well, it was your question. I think that, overweight versus underweight, here's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the physiological...
I'm not talking underweight. I'm talking normal weight. Versus normal, overweight women have more sex. They are more
sexually
active.
Have you ever been to college? Do you know what the guy expects from a woman who's overweight?
Really? Is that your basis for this? College guys?
No. You're saying who's having more sex, and it's not unknown that overweight women might have more sex. Think of the bad scenario. You're putting that up like that's a positive. I want to talk to physiological aspects of sexuality, and we know that obesity causes problems with you hormonally. We know it causes problems in a fertility-wise, and we also know obesity is progressive.
Well, fertility,
so those
are
the things that I've talked
about. PCOS. I mean, that's
Yes, and there's a great
common
association with that and obesity.
And
is
causes weight gain.
There is nothing definitive that says it causes it. It says it's associated with it. They have not said obesity causes it. They've said that if you...
I find it interesting that you're hedging this study, and yet you're willing to say that heart disease or obesity causes heart disease when those just say it's correlated. So why are you saying correlated in this instance, yet with heart disease you're willing
let me tell you something. If you will eat right and exercise daily, your chances of averting sexual dysfunction and health problems are far better.
Okay, but what about the attractiveness? You've talked about what men like.
There are
studies that say that men like women with meat on their bones.
There are,
and in fact, I would prefer an overweight or even a woman that's in the obese category to a woman that's like your size and shape. I think that is.
Well, what is my size and shape? What do you mean by my size and shape?
Well, you're 125. I've seen pictures of you. You are close to the underweight category, according to what I've read of your height and weight. You are on the borderline of underweight.
Really? I'm on the borderline of underweight. I've never been...
How tall are you?
5'6".
5'6 and 125.
I weighed like 117, I think that puts me at the borderline of underweight. Well, at any rate, I've never been anything but a healthy weight. I think that if you want to increase your odds for healthy fertility, healthy sexuality, healthy brain function, healthy body function, you want to eat right and exercise daily. You want to try to avoid putting on extra fat. From an anthropological standpoint, you can talk to Helen Fisher about this at Rutgers. I speak to her regularly. From a historic standpoint, a healthy heterosexual male is typically going to find a woman whose waist...
So are you saying I'm not healthy?
No, I'm talking categorically. I'm not really interested in specifically.
That's the thing. You take things categorically, and yet,
I don't care who you particularly are attracted to or who I'm particularly attracted to. I'm talking about categorically that the healthy heterosexual male is typically attracted to a woman whose waist-to-hip ratio is their waist is about 0.7 to 0.8.
And you think that has nothing to do with media messaging? That the fact that every movie
That's a historic... It's about a successful reproductive outcome.
Do you know who Lillian Russell is?
Not off the top of my head.
Okay, turn of the century. Turning into the 20th century, Lillian Russell was the sexiest star out there. She weighed 200 pounds. She had a huge appetite. She was fat. She's what you would call obese and hold up her pants and say, look how fat her ass is. And she was the sexual ideal at the turn of the 20th century.
Well, yeah, in corners of Uganda right now, the fattest women are also considered that. I'm not a real big proponent of fad weights, F-A-D weights. I think that... I wasn't a fan of the waist thing. I'm so glad we don't have that on the runway so much anymore. I think it's great that some of today's celebrities from Jessica Biel, Beyonce, Jennifer Lopez, Jennifer Garner, you're seeing women with muscle tone and a healthy amount of fat on their bodies. Women who, like Tori Spelling and Kelly Ripa Beckham. Victoria Beckham are looked at suspiciously.
Victoria Beckham
because
is nearly anorexic.
Well, you let me say, I just said...
A lot of these people are anorexic.
Excuse me, Shannon.
You're excused. Well,
Kelly Ripa, Victoria Beckham, Tori Spelling, I was listing people who are looked at suspiciously because they seem to be underweight.
They're held up as sexual.
No,
models.
They're not. They're considered with question, like something might be going on there. But what you're typically seeing today are women who seem to have muscle tone and a healthy amount of fat on their body held up as a more healthy ideal. And we've seen, thankfully, a reduction in this whole waif and underweight people on the runways. I think that high fashion has a real problem with it, but generally now you're seeing a better trend.
Shouldn't be fat women as sex symbols in media?
I that has no relevance to me. A sex symbol doesn't have to be, what drives people sexually as far as who they think is or isn't a sex symbol isn't exactly based on body weight. I'm talking about category.
That's what Hollywood uses. I mean, Hollywood.
Blame Hollywood for just. I don't really think we can
for body
blame
image?
The media.
You can't blame magazines, media for the idea that thin women are attractive to fat women are ugly.
I think the big difference
You think this country came by that naturally? Like, you think organically we decided this?
I don't know. I don't agree with you. I think that media right now is putting women with muscle tone and a healthy amount of body fat
at the
forefront.
How many years?
I'm talking about now. I've already discussed historically.
How long? Yeah, but historic, that's what I'm saying, is that
let me tell you something. I don't care what magazine
you put in. For the past 40 years, thin women have been the norm. Waifish women have been encouraged as the healthiest, sexiest women, and now suddenly, because in the last 5 years there's this push to have healthier looking women, you're saying that has nothing, the media has nothing to do with it. For the past 40 years, the last generation and a half, they've been pushing this image.
Okay, so you liked it when you saw the sex symbol or the media was pushing someone who was over fat. That was good, but when they...
I'm not saying it was good or bad. I'm just saying...
Okay, well, I haven't either. I just don't like to... Here's the thing that I think is fundamentally different about me than many people.
There's a lot of things that are fundamentally different from you than a lot of people.
Shannon, I think I've tried to be highly respectful to the fact that you and I have differing opinions.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that I've been as
agreeable...
But you
haven't been respectful to a lot of people.
Agreeable as possible to do this interview. I would like you to treat me with some sort of professionalism. And you know, here's the thing. The media doesn't always get it right. But when I hold myself responsible as a person and as a parent, I don't only put this negative media image in front of myself or my children. When you and I would go visit a newsstand right now, you don't just see skinny people on the cover. You see Angela Merkel. You see Michelle Obama. You see Ben Bernanke. I don't know.
And you see Sonia Sotomayor being criticized for being too fat to be a justice of the peace.
I hadn't read that.
Really?
I didn't see all the
criticisms of how fat she was. Or Regina Benjamin. Well,
that's different. I think that if we had the head of the Fed had run up credit card debt before he was appointed, we'd say, whoa, does that make sense?
So you're saying that Regina Benjamin is a gluttonous fool. Is that what you're saying?
Why would you use those words?
Well, because you're saying that you're making the comparison of Ben Bernanke being irresponsible and reckless with his money, and Regina Benjamin being reckless with what?
Well, first of all, I haven't used any of those words, and I think that you shouldn't be hyperbolic, and I think we should be clear. I'm trying to draw a comparison.
Okay.
Ben Bernanke, he, not that, to my knowledge, that he had this issue, but before he was appointed, if we'd found out he had personal credit card or personal mortgage problems, we might say,
so
wow.
He was irresponsible with his finances. Is that right?
Let me finish my statement.
Am I summing that up correct?
No, you're not. What I'm trying to draw a comparison is that in a professional and personal way, Regina Benjamin is a decorated, highly renowned physician. She has no professional track record.
So you think she's ignorant to the fact that she should be eating healthy and exercising?
Shannon, you're suggesting things that I'm not saying.
Well, I'm asking you why you think she's unhealthy.
I'm trying to answer the question, Shannon, and
okay.
I'd appreciate if you would allow me to do that.
Okay.
Regina Benjamin has no professional track record for addressing or reducing obesity and type 2 diabetes in her community. She's a renowned, decorated, honored, beloved physician.
I don't think that's true. As far as her not addressing obesity,
she has no track record for reversing obesity in her community or type 2 diabetes.
Who has a track record for reversing obesity? Name me one doctor who has reversed obesity in their area. Name me one.
I think any doctor who is up for the surgeon general, there are many physicians who work with patients.
So if no doctors have ever reversed obesity in their area, who the hell are we going to nominate for surgeon general?
I think you'd want to nominate someone who has a track record for addressing obesity and type 2 diabetes.
I think she does. I'm almost certain.
She doesn't.
Really?
She does not have a track record for successfully addressing
obesity
or
type 2
diabetes.
The keyword there is successfully.
Yes, she has. And there are many physicians who are experts in those areas.
But have they successfully addressed obesity?
Well, certainly within the sphere that they influence, and
which
that
one?
Is not an area.
Which
where
one? Who has
there are many physicians. Well, you can look at many physicians from David Katz at Yale. You can look at Walter Willett at Harvard. You can look at David Ludwig at Harvard.
They have found a way to reverse obesity, is what you're saying.
Shannon, I think that we need to stay within the realm of what I specifically said,
okay.
Which is within their
sphere. So Walter Willett has successfully done what to obesity? Studied it?
Walter Willett had... You know what? Look, this is off track, and I don't really appreciate your tone. I think I made my point clear when I said that she, Dr. Regina Benjamin, with all of her commendations and the positive will toward her and the love of her community and the awards and the recognition. She does not have a specific expertise or track record in addressing obesity or type 2 diabetes. And right now, at this time, in our current state where obesity is such a pressing issue and type 2 diabetes is such a pressing issue, a better selection for Surgeon General would be someone who has an expertise in that area, based on my viewpoint. I'm not saying you agree with that. I'm saying that is my view, and I want to be clear about my view.
Okay. I want to be clear about my view that, you know, nobody has found a solution for obesity, and the things that she promotes as far as obesity are online with pretty much every other expert on obesity, including Dr. Arya Sharma in Canada, who does not promote weight loss. He says to not promote weight loss. He says to promote weight maintenance. I'm not sure what message you're trying to get out there as far as reversing obesity. You can't reverse obesity.
I'm talking about the reversing of obesity trends, and I thought I was very clear in our conversation when I talked about
reversing
the pre-pregnancy
obesity,
to 5-year-old.
The trend for the last 10 years is nothing. It's flat. It's nil. The trend is no gain.
What we want to do.
You want to reverse that?
What we want to do, Shannon, you know what? Let's just go ahead and I
you know
think
what,
you
Mimi,
kind
on behalf of fierce, free-thinking fatties everywhere, fuck you emaciated, ignorant clown.
Hello again. This is Shannon. I just wanted to apologize to Ms. Roth. I don't feel like it was fair for me to call her emaciated. What we're trying to do with fat acceptance is get people to stop treating us differently because of our bodies. And as such, we should not, you know, disrespect other people for their bodies, whatever they are. You know, thin, fat, doesn't matter. We should respect each other for that. And so I was out of line in calling her emaciated. Now, I consulted with several people about this prior to publishing this and got several opinions, some people saying it should be edited out, which at first I was in favor of. But I spoke to a few other people, including Mama V over at We Are the Real Deal, and she works with teenage girls who have eating disorders and or are recovering from eating disorders, and she encouraged me to leave it in, and the reason being that she sees the damage that people like MeMe Roth do every day, that they are pushing this impossible ideal, and that by leaving it in, by attacking her on her body, that it may have an impact with some girls out there. That we are discouraging that kind of body type, the nearly underweight frame body type that causes girls to indulge in very dangerous, reckless, and deadly behaviors, quite frankly. And so I've decided to leave it in, but I want to apologize. I do think it's out of line personally for me to call for respect of fat people if I'm not going to respect thin people based solely on their body. Now, as such, I think the fuck you definitely stands, as does the ignorant clown. No apology there, but I would like to apologize for calling her emaciated. So, that's all. I'm sick and tired of hearing.